Of Esther. My plan of action at this point is we will go through the book of Esther. And starting this fall in September, we're going to go through the book of Revelation. For the purpose of being exhorted by its profound truths, not a time of trying to chart everything out as if we understand every single detail. There's much to be understood. But as we have looked at the book of Ruth, and as we are looking now at the book of Esther, what we're seeing is this sovereign God who is ultimately in control of all things. And that's what I'm hoping we will see in the book of Revelation as well, is that God is sovereign, he is in control, he brings all of history to consummation, and we can take a great encouragement that no matter what our struggles on earth, and many times they can look very dark and dismal, ultimately God's triumph moves forward. And no matter what your particular stance is on Revelation or how you interpret that, I think we all have the same triumph to rejoice in, the triumph of the Lamb who has overcome Satan and has overcome death. And by our faith in Jesus Christ, we have overcome. As John the Apostle said in 1 John chapter 4, that it is our faith that has overcome the world. Yes, we who believe that Jesus is the Christ, we have overcome the world. And in Revelation chapter 12, it's those who have washed their robes in the blood of Christ, those who through the blood and the word of their testimony, and they love not their lives unto the death, are those who have overcome. So that's what we're going to be heading toward this fall. So hopefully we'll get through the book of Esther before next year. No, we will. But today we're going to go to Esther, the end of chapter 2. We didn't have quite enough time last week to finish the end of the chapter. The title I gave to today's message is The Trail of the Serpent. The Trail of the Serpent. And as we get into chapter 3, you'll see what I'm talking about there. Chapter 2, starting with verse 19. If you remember, last week we looked at the choice of Esther. She was made to be the queen, and how amazing it was that you have this king, King Ahasuerus, seated upon his throne in the biblical narrative, representing that, if you will, that seed of the serpent, the powers of the world that are arraigned against the kingdom of God. And you have throughout Scripture, and you see culminating in Revelation, you have this battle of the city of God, the Jerusalem, against the city of evil Babylon. And so what you're going to have now is you're going to have on the throne in Persia, you'll have the king of Persia, but the evil city Babylon, and seated right at his side, Esther, the woman through whom God in that instance will crush Satan. So throughout Scripture, God wins the triumph, and his sovereignty is so clear in this book. And as the weeks are going by, as I've been studying and meditating in this book, it's getting more and more exciting to see how, from a worldly perspective, just it looks like so much is going wrong. I don't know about you, but if I were in their circumstance, the Jewish circumstance, which we'll see today, I would really be upset. And yet we see that all along God is moving. God was forming Esther in her mother's womb long before any of these events. He had already made provision for the redemption of the Jewish people. So starting with verse 19 of chapter 2, now when the virgins were gathered together the second time, Mordecai was sitting at the king's gate. He was sitting there because he had a position of authority, And the king's gate was not just a little gate, it was huge. And in fact, there's been some reconstructions of what that city gate may have looked like, and it looked more like a huge room than it did just simply a gate. And that's the place where many decisions and judgments were made. It was almost like a courthouse, if you will. And problems were resolved there. People who would want to come and petition the government would meet in the city gate. And Mordecai had access and dwelt in that city gate during the day. He was an official, and I'm not exactly sure what his title would have been, but he sits in the king's gate. Esther had not made known her kindred or her people as Mordecai had commanded her. For Esther obeyed Mordecai, just as when she was brought up by him. In those days, as Mordecai was sitting at the king's gate, Bigthan and Teresh, two of the king's eunuchs who guarded the threshold, became angry and sought to lay hands on King Ahasuerus. And this came to the knowledge of Mordecai, and he told it to Queen Esther. And Esther told the king in the name of Mordecai. When the affair was investigated and found to be so, the men were both hanged on the gallows. And it was recorded in the book of the Chronicles in the presence of the king. It says Esther obeyed Mordecai in not revealing her who her people were, what her nationality was. It's amazing to read sometimes the different commentaries and so on, and the theories that people come up with. They're talking about probably the biggest one I've come across, and by respected scholars as well, is that she was uncomfortable with her ethnicity, that she was more of a secular person, and she was torn between her faith and being a part of the king's palace and being a part of that secular culture. I don't see that at all. First of all, she's being obedient to the one who raised her, her cousin Mordecai. And it says it right there, for Esther obeyed Mordecai just as when she was brought up by him. The main point I want to bring out in this paragraph, though, is that it says here, and this came to the knowledge of Mordecai, this plan. That's the sovereignty of God. Now, the sovereignty of God for good, kind of like what Kim was talking about before as she read Jeff's blog this week, and I'd read it too, and that we see the good things as blessings, and we see the bad things as, well, we often don't see them as blessings, but God uses them, and they are blessings. Ultimately, all things work together for good, for those who love God, who are the called according to his purpose. And here we have a situation where Mordecai discovers this, which is a good thing. He discovers this plan, and then he makes it known to Esther, who makes it known to the king, and it's recorded in the book, and Mordecai gets the credit. The only problem is, and here's the bad part that looks like it's not a blessing, is Mordecai wasn't acknowledged or rewarded for it. Normally in that kingdom, if you did a favor for the king, it would have been recognized and you would have been honored. But he wasn't honored. It was almost as if he had done nothing at this point. Now, remember that you got to try to use your imagination a little bit and think of what the first readers would have been thinking there. Most of us know this storyline, so we know what's going to happen later. But you've got to think through what would have been the reaction back then. What would have been going through Mordecai's mind? He's been faithfully serving, and he doesn't even get any acknowledgement. I'm not saying that he was looking for praise, but because it was something the kings did, you would think that he would have been honored or recognized in some way. But he was not. So there might be a question like, why, God? You know, why? And chapter 3, after these things, King Ahasuerus promoted Haman, the Agagite, the son of Hammedatha. And as I brought out the Agagite, he was an Amalekite, an enemy of Israel. And I've emphasized that in past weeks. But notice the juxtaposition here. Notice how Mordecai is like overlooked. And the Agagite, the Amalekite, the enemy of Israel, Haman, is promoted. Doesn't that seem not fair? It says, and advanced him. So the king promotes and advances Haman and set his throne above all the officials who were with him. And all the king's servants who were at the king's gate bowed down and paid homage to Haman, for the king had so commanded concerning him. But Mordecai did not bow down or pay homage. Then the king's servants who were at the king's gate said to Mordecai, "Why do you transgress the king's command?" And when they spoke to him day after day, and he would not listen to them, they told Haman in order to see whether Mordecai's words would stand, for he had told them that he was a Jew. Otherwise, he was, you know, communicating the fact that I don't have to bow down because I am Jewish. And when Haman saw that Mordecai did not bow down or pay homage to him, Haman was filled with fury. And he disdained to lay hands on Mordecai alone, so as they had made known to him the people of Mordecai, Haman sought to destroy all the Jews, the people of Mordecai, throughout the whole kingdom of Ahasuerus. A couple of things. When I was reading this, one of the thoughts that came to my mind is that whole question again as to why. Why is Haman promoted? You know, why is he advanced? Have you ever, the day after an election, whether it's the president or a governor or a senator or whatever, the day after, say, why? You know, I actually said to God, would you believe I actually said this? And I did repent. I promise I repent. I said to God, what were you thinking? You know? Anyways, as if God's knowledge and wisdom is somehow at my level, and I could say that, right? I mean, that was ridiculous. But anyway, I did repent, I promise. But here's one of those situations where Haman is promoted. You know, God is going to use this situation for his purposes. And I think there's a lesson for us here as well. We don't always understand the whys. Why are certain people put in positions of leadership, and people who seem more like they would fit the position, more qualified, more experienced, they're passed over? But I think if we could go back and remind ourselves often of what's happening here in this storyline, there's so much truth in this book. Things that can encourage us when we don't have all the answers. We can see how God has worked before with the confidence that he is the sovereign God who is in control, even when it looks like he's not. Okay? Now, the king himself has commanded the people bow down to Haman, but I think what we're seeing in this passage is that Haman has a problem. First of all, he's absolutely filled with fury that somebody wouldn't bow down to him. He seems like a very prideful individual. And I don't know how he came to the place of being advanced, but he may have been pushing some buttons as well, advancing himself in some ways. I don't know. But he wants to not only see Mordecai dead, he wants all the Jews killed. And even though the author doesn't come right out and say it, I think it's very clear that Haman is using this situation with Mordecai as an excuse. He doesn't all of a sudden become anti-Semitic at one moment. He's saying, well, darn it, if Mordecai is not bowing down to me, I'm going to just kill them all. I don't think that's what's happening. It's here's an opening now. And I hate these Jewish people that are living here in Susa and throughout Persia. I hate them. It's a hatred that's coming out, and here's an open door for him to do something about a prejudice and a hate. There has been, of course, a long history of animosity between Israel and the Amalekites, as we've looked at. But I think what's happening here is something's coming out of Haman that's part of who he is. And of course we know, and that's why I call it the trail of the serpent, that ultimately Satan is using the hate and the anger because he wants to destroy the Jews. This is the last, as I've already said, this is the last instance in the Old Testament of Satan's attempt to stop the seed of the woman from coming into the world, namely Jesus Christ. This is an all-out attempt to destroy all Jewish people because Persia reigned over an entire territory from Pakistan, the Bible says India, but it's northern India, which is now called Pakistan, all the way to the river of Egypt, which would have included all of the land of Canaan or Israel. So Satan's goal was to have a massive destruction of the Jewish people. Boy, have things not changed. Man, throughout history, we see that the serpent is always on the trail of the seed of the woman. This anti-Semitism continues on, and it continues today. You know, when you watch the situation today of what's going on in Israel, listen to the media. The anti-Semitism is profound. And you just think of Adolf Hitler and the extinction of 6 million Jews. It's something, it's a theme that goes on and on and on and on. Satan hates Israel. It's through Israel that the Word of God came, and it's through Israel that the Messiah has come. And according to Paul the Apostle in Romans 11, God has a future purpose for the people of Israel as he will bring them to repentance and to faith in Jesus Christ. I believe that the vision of the Valley of Dry Bones is and will be fulfilled, and that Israel as a people will come to life in Jesus Christ, becoming one with him, and therefore Jew and Gentile all being joined together as one in Christ, as the bride of Christ, the redeemed of the Lord. It's interesting that a note I wrote down here is that Psalm 118, verse 8, is the middle verse of the whole Bible. I one time had this study Bible with a whole bunch of stats like that, like how many words, how many letters, how many verses, how many chapters, blah, blah, blah. And what were the middle verses, etc.? Well, the middle verse of the whole Bible is Psalm 118, verse 8. Which says, it is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. Isn't that interesting? Not that God inspired the verses. Those are done by man. In fact, we didn't have verses in the entire Bible until 1560. But still, you know, I just find that kind of interesting. And that seems to be something we're going to be seeing here, is to take refuge in the Lord and not to look to man, something that Esther and Mordecai will be doing in a big way, as well as many of the Jewish people who will be seeking God. So Haman seeks to destroy all the Jews. Verse 7, in the first month, which is the month of Nisan, in the 12th year of King Ahasuerus, they cast Pur. That is, they cast lots before Haman day after day, and they cast it month after month until the 12th month, which is the month of Adar. Then Haman said to King Ahasuerus, Otherwise, they kept casting lots to find out when this destruction of the Jews should be carried out. Then Haman said to King Ahasuerus, there is a certain people, he won't say who they are, he just says there's a certain people, scattered abroad and dispersed among the peoples in all the provinces of your kingdom. Their laws are different from those of every other people. Of that he's telling the truth. And they do not keep the king's laws. Lie. Isn't that weird that somebody's lying about Israel and the Jewish people? So that it's not to the king's profit to tolerate them. If it please the king, let it be decreed that they be destroyed. And I will pay 10,000 talents of silver into the hands of those who have charge of the king's business, that they may put it into the king's treasury. What's interesting is 10,000 talents of silver in the Persian Empire at the time would have been 2/3 of the king's yearly revenues. That's a lot of money. Now, where is Haman going to get that kind of money? I don't think he's necessarily that wealth. He plans on plundering all the Jewish people who will be killed. So the king took his signet ring from his hand and gave it to Haman the Agagite, the son of Hammedatha. And notice Agagite is emphasized again. He's the enemy of the Jews. And the king said to Haman, the money is given to you. The people also do with them as it seems good to you. You can do with them as you will. Now, it doesn't say that the king said, who are these people? He just says, go ahead to Haman. It shows, at least it tells me he's not thinking a whole lot. I think part of what's going on here is, if you remember at the beginning of the book, he's having this huge celebration, trying to consolidate all of his generals and an army that's going to go in and try to defeat Greece. But what he's going to do is he will have about 1 million soldiers together as they go to infiltrate Greece to defeat them. But it just so happens that Greece has a navy that destroys at least 250,000 of Ahasuerus' soldiers, and he retreats and goes back to Persia in defeat. So the timing couldn't be better to come to the king and said, you know, there's a people scattered all throughout that really aren't good for you, that are really not for your profit. Remember, he just faced a huge defeat. And he certainly doesn't need more enemies infiltrating his whole kingdom. You see Satan's timing in all of this. Anyways, so the king's scribes were summoned on the 13th day of the first month, and an edict according to all that Haman commanded was written to the king's satraps, to the governors over all the provinces, and to the officials of all the peoples, to every province in its own script, and every people in its own language. It was written in the name of King Ahasuerus and sealed with the king's signet ring. Letters were sent by couriers to all the king's provinces with instructions to destroy, to kill, and to annihilate all Jews, young and old, women and children. In one day, the 13th day of the 12th month, which is the month of Adar, and to plunder their goods. A copy of the document was to be issued as a decree in every province by proclamation to all the peoples to be ready for that day. The couriers went out hurriedly by order of the king, and the decree was issued in Susa, the citadel. And the king and Haman sat down to drink. But the city of Susa was thrown into confusion. Isn't that something that the politicians, the king and Haman sit down and just relax? It's like, so what? Of course, the city itself is thrown absolutely into confusion. I think that even this would be referring to the Persians as well. I mean, they're like, what is this all about? Amazing. And once again, the couriers in verse 15 went out hurriedly by the order of the king. It is a historical fact, and I believe I brought this up a couple of weeks ago, that the kingdom of Persia had an amazing postal system of spreading the king's messages throughout the kingdom. When Mordecai learned all that had been done, Mordecai tore his clothes and put on sackcloth and ashes and went out into the midst of the city, and he cried out with a loud and bitter cry. He went up to the entrance of the king's gate, for no one was allowed to enter the king's gates clothed in sackcloth. You weren't to be mourning in the king's gate or in the presence of the king. And if you remember, if you've read the book of Nehemiah, how Nehemiah was grieving over the condition of Jerusalem, and this is sometime after Esther, probably about 20, 30 years later, when King Artaxerxes was reigning and Nehemiah was his cupbearer, and Nehemiah goes into his presence and King Artaxerxes says to him, "You're down, you're feeling sad. What's wrong, what's going on?" Now, Nehemiah could have been put to death for walking into the presence of the king looking despondent. But he, of course, was not. And I think King Artaxerxes, who's, by the way, the son of Ahasuerus here, he had mercy on Nehemiah. So now Mordecai goes right into the king's gates in great lamentation and mourning. When Esther's young women and her eunuchs came and told her, the queen was deeply distressed. She sent garments to clothe Mordecai. She's worried for Mordecai, so that he might take off his sackcloth, but he would not accept them. Then Esther called for Hathach, one of the king's eunuchs, who had been appointed to attend her, and ordered him to go to Mordecai to learn what this was and why it was. Hathach went out to Mordecai in the open square of the city in front of the king's gate. And Mordecai told him all that had happened to him, and the exact sum of money that Haman had promised to pay into the king's treasuries for the destruction of the Jews. Mordecai also gave him a copy of the written decree issued in Susa for their destruction, that he might show it to Esther and explain it to her and command her to go to the king to beg his favor and plead with him on behalf of her people. Guess what? When it says plead with him, the king, on behalf of her people, Mordecai is now revealing who she is. So it's now clear, at least to her servants and to the women who are waiting on her, that she is Jewish. And also Mordecai is saying, now is the time to go reveal who you are to the king. And Hathach went and told Esther what Mordecai had said. Then Esther spoke to Hathach and commanded him to go to Mordecai and say, "All the king's servants and the people of the king's provinces know that if any man or woman goes to the king inside the inner court without being called, there is but one law to put him to death. You cannot go into the presence of the king unless the king has asked you to come into his presence." Even his own wife, and actually wives and concubines, he had several, but the queen herself could not come into the king's presence unless the king had asked her to. So all the king's servants, she says, know, and the people of the king's provinces know, that if any man or woman goes to the king inside the inner court without being called, there's but one law to be put to death, except the one to whom the king holds out the golden scepter so that he may live. But as for me, I have not been called to come into the king these 30 days. She says, it's been a little while. It's been about 30 days. I haven't been called into his presence, which would not have necessarily been unusual at the time at all. I don't think there's anything we need to read into that. There was somehow a rift in their relationship. This was pretty traditional for the kings in Persia. What I see here is I see an element of fear, but caution. She's saying to Mordecai, do you realize that if I do what you're asking, it could be my death? I could die. And I think that Esther had even more reason to be a little bit fearful here, because remember, Vashti did something willfully. Actually, the opposite. She was told to come into the presence of the king, and she refused. It didn't cost her her life, but she was no longer the queen, and King Ahasuerus found a new queen. So Esther has some caution here, and no doubt an element of fear. And they told Mordecai what Esther had said, and we're going to be reading here the key verses of this whole book, really. And Mordecai told them to reply to Esther, do not think to yourself that in the king's palace you will escape any more than all the other Jews. For if you keep silent at this time, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another place. But you and your father's house will perish. And who knows whether you have not come to the kingdom for such a time as this? Then Esther told them to reply to Mordecai, go. Gather all the Jews to be found in Susa and hold a fast on my behalf, and do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my young women will also fast as you do. Then I will go to the king, though it is against the law, and if I perish, I perish. Mordecai then went away and did everything as Esther had ordered him. Wow. That's a powerful passage for us here. So we see that she experiences some fear, some legitimate fear. But I believe she is a woman of faith. Now, the particular commentary I'm reading, the author's name is Karen Jobes, and she agrees with another great author who is a wonderful man, Leland Ryken. They believe that Queen Esther is somehow going through a conversion, that she has been somewhat vacillating in her faith, torn between the world of the palace, the secular world, and the world of the Jews who are now out living in the city. Her faith, a kind of a battle between her faith and her secular world. And I totally disagree with that. She is clearly, in making a decision like this, a woman of faith. That doesn't... What her resolve, if I perish, I perish, I'm just going to go, doesn't stir up on a moment of time. She doesn't conjure it up from somewhere. Mordecai brought her up in the faith. And you can see that Mordecai's faith is very strong here. He said, God will bring us deliverance from somewhere. If it's not you, he'll do it. Look at the confidence that Mordecai has. He refuses any kind of compromise in bowing down to Haman. It would not have been wrong necessarily to bow down to Haman, because he wasn't declaring himself some kind of a god or a deity. We don't know all the reasons of what's going on here. But we see that he's a man of resolve and a man of strong conviction and a man of faith. And he raised Esther, and God puts Esther in that position. I believe she's truly a woman of faith, and she's making a self-sacrificing choice. When we studied the book of Ruth, we saw that same characteristic in Ruth, didn't we? A woman who was self-sacrificing, who would look away from her own interests, even if it meant, you know, for in Esther's case, her own death. You know, that's to me the characteristic of a true leader. But before we point our finger at our leaders, it's also the characteristic, should be the characteristic of any disciple of Jesus Christ. So, Mordecai says, perhaps it's for this very reason that you're the queen. There's no way Mordecai knows all the sovereign workings of God. We can see it now. We're reading the story after the fact. He didn't know. He says, perhaps. And this is one of those accounts where I'm just amazed, because God used the faithfulness of one woman to go to petition the king in one moment of time that'll have a huge, huge impact in the world. God's covenant people will be preserved through this one individual. People, a lot of times we might look at our own lives. I know I certainly do in mine. And we wonder, well, you know, God, I really haven't been real fruitful. Or, you know, what's my purpose? I mean, you're doing so much through so-and-so, and it seems like I'm just on the wayside or in the back shelf somewhere in a back room. You know, I don't know if you've ever struggled with those kind of things. Plus, we have a Christian world and culture that tries to define success in ministry. But you know, what is success but faithfulness from a biblical standpoint? God calls us to faithfulness, to be followers of Jesus Christ, to be faithful disciples. And you know, if we're following Christ and we're being faithful to Him, and we're in His Word, and our faith is being built up and strengthened through His Word and through prayer, and just our abiding in Him, God will use us. However, I'm not sure. For Esther, it was just being faithful in the palace, in the middle of a secular world. Notice she has the women's servants all around her to fast with her. For a Jewish person, they didn't fast as an end in itself, like somehow fasting is magical. Fasting was only a vehicle for prayer. But remember, the author doesn't want to mention God or prayer or anything like that in the book of Esther. He's trying to show the hiddenness of God and His sovereign working in the midst of His hiddenness. So prayer isn't directly mentioned, but that's what the fasting is all about. So the picture I get is Esther has had a huge impact on these women, and they are fasting and praying with her. She's a woman of faith. She's faithful. And therefore, God is going to be able to use her. We're going to see Esther go into the presence of the king, but we'll do that next week. But we're going to go and we're going to see her petition as she steps forward. And she says, if I perish, I perish. You know, when Jesus Christ, and I'll close with this thought. When Jesus Christ told His followers, and I'm including us in that if we have faith in Christ, we're His disciples. He said, take up your cross and follow me. Take up your cross and follow me. What's interesting about a cross doesn't mean it's something you can take up and put down again. We often look at things and say, well, that's the cross in my life. No, a cross is an instrument of execution. And once somebody picked up the cross, they weren't going to be putting it down. You know, it's you weren't coming back. Anybody at that time who picked up a cross to carry it, that's because they were on their way to their execution. There was no coming back. That's what Jesus is communicating. Follow me completely. Follow 100%. Take up your cross knowing you'll never turn back. You'll follow me all the way, if necessary, to the death. Giving up everything for me. Being willing to give up our comforts and our sometimes our time, our sense of security. scripture that's really convicted me lately is in John chapter 12, right before Jesus faces his passion. He says this, chapter 12 of John's gospel, starting with verse 23, and Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it. And whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me. And where I am, there will my servant be also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him." The Father will honor him. "Unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone." Jesus is talking about his own death, but he's also calling his disciples to follow his example, to take up their cross and to follow him. Where our heart needs to be at as we learn a lesson from Esther is, number one, faithfulness. Day by day, moment by moment, in a secular world, continue to be faithful to him with a heart that says, "If I perish, I perish." Think about that. You know, we sing that song, "I Surrender All." Well, that's just another way of saying, "If I perish, I perish." This grain of wheat needs to fall into the ground and die. I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. I prefer his kingdom over my own life and this world. There's so much more that can be said about that, and it's hard, but we also know that we have the promise of a kingdom. When Jesus told his disciples to take up their cross and follow him, 8 days later, he took three of them up on a mountain and was transfigured before them, and they saw a preview of the King in his glory. That's the reward, if you will. He's your reward. Like he told Abraham, "I am your shield." That means I'm your king and your exceeding great reward. So yes, this grain of wheat must fall into the ground and die, but he who is life is our reward. Let's pray. God our Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the book of Esther. Father, thank you for Esther. Thank you for her faithfulness. And thank you for what you're going to accomplish through one young girl who remains faithful and is willing to lose all for God's purposes. Father, give us a heart. Give us a heart by your grace that says, "If I perish, I perish, but I will follow Jesus day by day." Father, this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. You want to stand for the doxology?